So George has mentioned John Webster and how influential John has been in the principal's own life and the life of many of us here. In 2008, John gave an interview that was published in the Christian Century, and he was asked this question: there seems to be renewed interest in systematic theology over the past decade or two. How would you account for that? John replied, "The renewed confidence that constructive theology is possible and worthwhile is probably the biggest change in theological culture since I was a graduate student in the late 1970s. The confidence has many roots. The steady decline of models of theology in which critical appraisal is the dominant task. Receptiveness toward and fresh engagement with classical thinkers, patristic, medieval, and Reformation. A sense that the Enlightenment is only one episode in the history of one, that is, Western culture, and not a turning point in the history of humankind. And then also the work of a number of gifted and independent-minded theologians, now at the height of their powers, who have shown the potency of constructive doctrinal work." John was speaking in 2008. He would not have included himself amongst the number of gifted, independent-minded theologians at the height of their powers. But John was, and John still was when I last saw him a month before he died. We grieve his loss enormously. And in a moment I'm going to introduce our speaker, but before I do so, let's just give thanks to God for John in the quietness of our hearts. We give thanks, O God, for your servant John. Give us a similar courage, a similar focus on the truth of the gospel, and a similar desire to proclaim it to the corners of the earth. For John Bainbridge Webster, may he rest in peace and rise in glory. Earlier in that interview of which I've spoken, John was asked this question, which may be apt to a good number of us here. Isn't it wonderful to see so many younger theologians amongst us? John was asked, if you were just starting out in theology today, what topics and issues would you want to tackle? He said, what I didn't get round to doing when I set out. Lots of exegesis, lots of historical theology, mastering the big texts of the traditions of the church. That is a program of which Dr. Pusey would have been in wholehearted agreement. It's a program which I know the principal is keen to encourage through the work of the house. And it is a work which our speaker this morning has done a great deal to foster to encourage and to exemplify in his own publications. Many of us will be familiar with one of the fattest books to have emerged in the last 20 years, the book which Oliver and Joan together published, containing major excerpts from the tradition of political theology in the church before the Enlightenment. The big texts of the traditions of the church have been a major focus of the work of Professor O'Donovan, as has exegesis and historical theology. When John said that one of the things which had renewed confidence and interest in systematic theology, he mentioned the work of a number of gifted and independent-minded theologians now at the height of their powers. I have no doubt that John would have had Professor O'Donovan in mind when he said that. And thank God, Oliver continues to be at the height of his powers, perhaps even more actively in retirement now that he doesn't have the burden of being Director of Graduate Studies and Chair of Faculty Boards and so on. He was, for many years, Regius Professor of Moral and Pastoral Theology at Oxford. Then he moved to Edinburgh to be Professor of Christian Ethics at the university there. And he is now working on a three-part project, two parts of which have been published, entitled Ethics as Theology. So for Professor O'Donovan, the work of constructive doctrinal reflection has never been separate from the work of moral reflection. So would you please welcome Professor O'Donovan as he comes to speak on the Trinity and the moral life in memoriam John Webster.
Dogmatics and ethics are a pair of terms often distinguished for pedagogical and administrative purposes, though among theologians there is rather little reflection on this distinction. But both John and I have given some attention to it from time to time, and his last published work, God Without Measure, that appeared earlier this year, just a month or two ago, is very considerably devoted to it. John possessed a remarkable skill in making distinctions. That gift, much cultivated in scholastic disputation, and prized above every other theological gift by Martin Luther. Modest and circumspect, the master distinguisher does not scatter oppositions promiscuously across the page merely to dazzle or bewilder us. He does not brandish them violently, slashing a path through country where a delicate ecology of complementarity ought to prevail. Each distinction, however remote, has to be brought before the bar of the founding distinctions, the distinction between creator and creature, the distinction between holiness and sin. And each has to bear witness to the gracious act of God, who reaches out across the gulf of these distinctions to embrace sinful humankind in partnership. John Webster made his distinctions like a surgeon teasing apart tissues of a living body, as respectful of their organic unity as of their difference, and knowing that when the operation is over, the tissues must bind harmoniously together again. In that scrupulous and patient work of discrimination, he was a standing example to his generation, serving the harmony with which theology must call upon God. In this, his last work, he posed the problem of dogmatics and ethics by way of the scholastic phrase agitur, agere sequitur esse, to act follows being. On the one hand, dogmatic reason had to have its prospective moment at which it looked forward to temporal enactment of its truth. It had to be open to being enlarged by moral theological reflection. On the other hand, practical moral theology, all organized towards deliberation and action, had to have its retrospective moment, drawing upon an understanding of what is said about God and God's works. In an earlier essay, in the domain of the word, he warned of the disorder of thinking of dogmatics and morals as discrete disciplines, each with its own domain and procedures, but went on to suggest that they are coherent, reflective activities directed to some particular aspect of a common object, the mystery of God and the work of God. In the later essay, the two enterprises come together on a field that he calls moral theology, which is common both to dogmatics and ethics. The first principles of human moral history, which dogmatics must reach and Christian practical reason must be able to draw upon reflectively. A material priority, he thinks, is to be assigned to dogmatics, because the movement of Christian teaching is from God to created things. Yet, since theology is a mixed knowledge acquired not only speculatively but also practically, dogmatics must expect enrichment, illumination, or expansion from the considerations of morals and ascetics. Now, your invitation to take up the topic of the Trinity and the moral life, left vacant by John Webster's early summons to leave this world, has led me to address a neglected aspect of a thesis of my own. I have argued in recent years that moral reason needs to be understood as having a threefold reference to the agent self, to the world that comprises the order of values, and to the horizon of emerging time before which we deliberate on action. The impasse into which modern moral reason constantly runs, frequently diagnosed by philosophers, springs from a tendency to be monothematic, to be unable to reconcile these three points of reference, and that leaves modern man with intolerable alternatives between stagnation on the one hand and unrooted spasmodic exertion on the other, with no imagination of what it is to be ourselves as we act, taking new steps in faithful enactment of the good we have seen and loved. I've developed my plea for a better and fuller account of moral reason in terms of the Pauline triad of faith, love, and hope, but have deliberately made no connection between those two triads and the Holy Trinity, and I expect the reason for that omission will be quite obvious. The Trinity is a dogmatician theme, if ever there was one. An understanding of the triune God has to prove itself on terms proper to what we may know of divine life. An analysis of moral reason has to prove itself on terms proper to human life. The seduction of the number three, one of the most magical numbers that ever passes through a deluded human being's head, the seduction of the number three should not tempt us to confuse those two tasks. and to represent our moral reason as some kind of direct image of the Godhead. That would be the theological equivalent of what the political theorists call rather nicely living metaphysically. Converting a contingent practical decision into some ultimate statement of reality without any mediating factors. Recently, a bishop exhorting his church to a frank and charitable approach to their disagreements was reported to have said, "We do not have to be afraid of disagreements. The Godhead has disagreements among its members." A train of thought one might judge equally disastrous to dogmatic theology and to moral reason. We cannot recall it too much. Making God in our own image is idolatry. On the other hand, divinizing worldly differences or positions is an evasion of their complex challenges. Yet, if ethics cannot take a lead in the discourse about the Trinity, it can at least listen and respond. In John Webster's view, moral theology is, he says, distributed across the corpus of dogmatics, and there is a moral theological derivative of all theological doctrines, and he singles out the one principal Christian doctrine of God the Holy Trinity. So ethics, remaining within its own sphere of competence, can trace such correspondences as may be shown us between the forms of human action and what we have been told of the being and acts of God. Let me then put before you a broad thesis. It takes a Trinitarian God to elicit purposeful human action. Now, I had intended to illustrate that thesis with two rather nice pieces of music, which I have to say the contrast between which a sort of Unitarian picture of man's union with God and a Trinitarian picture of man's union with God, the contrast between those two pieces of music put this thesis into my mind to start with. But I woke up this morning suddenly convinced of the falsity of W.B. Yeats's claim that old men ought to dance. And so I'm not venturing into that field. And anyway, when I reflected on it, I thought, I don't think John Webster would have done that. So I think, true to his very close focus on the task, we will just take the thesis as it comes. The thesis is that it takes a Trinitarian God to elicit purposeful human action. And we want to see whether that thesis can find any theological support. Here I want to turn to what is in effect a locus classicus in the New Testament, for the interrelation of the triune Godhead with the formation of the life of faith. And I had in mind the farewell discourses of St. John's Gospel, the whole of the three chapters, 14, 15, and 16, is very germane to that theme, but I shall concentrate mainly on chapter 14. Right at the fore of that discussion there is the opening words, is human agency. Let not your hearts be troubled. Hearts, of course, not in the romantic sense, as pure receptors of emotional stimulus, registers of feeling, but hearts as always in the Old and New Testament, representing the seat of practical reason. So, confusion and instability threaten the disciples' capacity to live and act. On the other hand, the condition of stable agency is fully realized in them. You believe in God. But a as anyone who has read the Gospel to this point knows, belief in God means belief in his presence in Jesus. So the scope of that statement is immediately extended. You believe also in me. The first of the three sections of this chapter, as I've analysed them, explores at length the relation between Jesus and the Father as the way of approach to God and the truth and the life of God speaking. When Philip demands, "Show us the Father and it will suffice us," he has not yet fully grasped this relation. He is the aspiring Philophilos, the friend of God, a familiar figure in the ancient world, whose hope to see God, to see the Father, is a hope to be taken somewhere else than where the Father is visible in Jesus, which is to say, the world they have known with Jesus and the history they have lived with Jesus. The relation of Jesus and the Father is then developed in terms of Jesus' words and works. The disciples have received teaching. Teaching about how when they live before God. And they have seen works. They have seen a life of effective activity in the power and presence of God performed by Jesus. And in those words and those works, they have seen the Father too. And thus the thought returns to where it began at the beginning of the chapter, the disciples' faith in verse 11. Believe me that I am in the Father and the Father is in me. Believe on account of the works themselves. From this point, a new horizon immediately opens up in the next verse. The disciples who believe in God through the works they have seen in Jesus are themselves to be active. One who believes in me will do the works that I do, and greater works, because I go to the Father. And the ground on which that is to happen is the focus of the remainder of this chapter. The condition for the disciples' works to be greater than Jesus' works is, of course, paradoxically, that they are to be the same as Jesus' works. They will do Jesus' works. Works morally and evangelically consistent with what Jesus has done. A faithful representation of Jesus' life. An active participation in his agency. Yet, since the time of Jesus' presence comes to an end and he goes away, these future works will reach beyond the temporal scope of his presence in the world and so, in some sense, constitute an enlargement of that presence through time, an extension of his decisive accomplishment. And it's at that point that we meet the first fully Trinitarian formulation in this chapter. The works that the disciples will do are founded on a relation with God as Father, God as Son, and God as Paraclete. As petitioner, the believer is placed directly vis-à-vis the Father, asking in Jesus' name. That, at any rate, is the clear formulation we are given in chapter 16, verse 23, and I believe that it should govern our understanding of 14:13. Despite a degree of textual uncertainty about 14:13, it is the Father that the disciples are asking. Petitionary prayer is the foundational form that faith takes in action. The first way in which the agent lays claim on a world and a good that is not yet present but waits to be opened up. The Father then has not disappeared behind the Son and the Spirit, but the Father is addressed in his own person as ruler of history. The believer's relation to the Son is then described in rather different terms. If you love me, you will keep my commands. And then the relation to the spirit of truth is stated again differently as that of receiving and becoming indwelt by the Paraclete. Let us pause on the striking fact that the disciples are said to love Jesus. In this text, the Father himself is said to love, of course, to love the believer on the one hand, and to love Jesus on the other. Jesus is also said to love. He loves the Father. But the believer who asks the Father in Jesus' name loves Jesus. That is John's formulation at this point. For it is in Jesus that the Father's presence in the world can be seen and known, and love implies a world of value, an objective, visible order of good that it can relate to. So what we have here, I suggest, in this sequence of faith in the Father and love for Jesus is a Johannine way of imagining the Pauline formula, faith working through love. At the centre of the farewell discourse, we find Jesus developing this point quite uniquely in New Testament language in terms of a friendship between himself and the disciples. I call you friends, I no longer call you servants, because a servant does not know what his master is doing. And the importance of that concept of friendship is underlined, I think, when the term returns at the end of the Gospel in the famous exchange between Jesus and Peter by the Sea of Galilee in chapter 21. You remember it? Jesus asks, agapaisman? And Peter answers, philos. Pages and pages and pages of commentary, of course. But all I want to say is that one can only understand philos if one relates it back to I have called you friends. What may strike modern readers as unexpected in all this is the strong insistence, both here and repeatedly in chapter 15, on the connection between love of Jesus and observing his commands. Jesus' commands are, he insists, the Father's commands too. And Jesus has kept those commands as well as given those commands. But they are Jesus' commands because they have disclosed the active will of God for life within the world through Jesus' works. It is Jesus who has lived in the world as the human life that God created it for. So this is the connection we so easily lose touch with between loving and obeying. Meaningful and effective moral patterns show us loveliness and beauty in good order. What we love when we love Jesus is a perfect fittingness, a human life just such as the world was made to contain. And our love makes his active and effective human existence normative for us. He continues present to the disciples, dwelling within them through his words. His commands are the normative formulation that express his own life. And in giving his disciples not only words of revelation, but words of command, normative words, Jesus opens for them a way to participate in the deep rationality of the world order that he shares with the Father, the world order called forth through the Logos that became flesh. Most of the section of this chapter, which I take to run from verse 12 to 24, focuses on the continuing experience of Jesus in love and obedience, even when the world does not see him. That is, when his presence on earth is recalled as an object of faith and not a sight. The third section then moves on to the more threatening terrain of the experience of the absence of Jesus. with a recall of the threat to agency. Let not your heart be disturbed. Do not shrink. Here the presence of the paraclete comes to the fore. This has already been announced in the programmatic statement of 13 to 16. I will ask the Father, and he will give you another paraclete to be with you for all time, es aiona, introducing the future horizon of the disciples, looking forward rather than backward to the one who has done the works. If God is present to them on their past horizon of their accomplished experience of the works and words of Christ, God is also present to them on the future horizon of their emerging experience of time in the guidance of the Spirit of Truth who continues with and in the Church. The emerging time, the absence of Jesus, do not then constitute a defeat for the Father's works, even though time defeats all the works of humankind. There is progress within the works of God, the Spirit offering new knowledge as time requires it, but always bringing them back to the teaching and commands of Jesus. Though a fuller exposition of the Spirit's role is reserved for chapter 16, his place in the economy of divine grace and human action is quite clear from that point on. So what we see in this text is the Godhead really present in time, in the accomplished history of Jesus, and in the emerging future of the disciples' lives, and no less in transcendent control of the course of history. The living of the life of faith corresponds to that pattern, rooted in love of the past world of Jesus' presence on earth, anticipating the disclosures of the Spirit within emerging time, always calling on one who enables our agency by allowing our petitions. The correspondence between the shape of God's Trinitarian presence and the shape of Christian practical engagement then is very evident in that text. So, what may we conclude from that? Have we, to evoke a term heavy with resonances, stumbled upon an analogy of the Trinity within Christian moral reasoning? Let us construct an answer to that question in three steps. First, any account of human moral reason must speak of nothing less than of what humans as such are made to be and do. No privileging of Trinitarian approaches should let us suppose that Adam and his progeny, whether innocent or fallen, could simply have been without agency. God did not create mankind like that. That practical reason should need to relate to the agent self, to the world, and to emerging time is how things are and have been from the beginning. If we seek and achieve a better and fuller understanding of practical reason, that will, in the first place, be a better understanding of Adam, not an understanding of a better Adam. Yet because moral reasoning always involves reflection, both on the world and on itself, its exercise is hindered by misunderstanding and empowered by truth, the truth of the world and the truth of moral reason itself. So we may then say, in the second place, that a better and fuller understanding of moral reason enhances the power to exercise moral reason well and helps us to overcome our natural tendency to reason lazily, carelessly, impulsively, or perhaps sometimes not at all. Moral reason, that is, must understand itself if it is to fulfill itself. Good moral theory, though not as such a proof of sanctification of any kind, does have a positive bearing on sanctification. There are a thousand ways of misconceiving human agency and action. All of them tend to some typical loss of agency and miscarriage of action. It's possible to conceive human action as simply creative self-expression. It's possible to conceive it as merely resting in God. It is possible to conceive it as holy goblets, as a function of our life without God in the world. One remembers Plotinus, admired by Porphyry for his conscientiousness with the domestic accounts, even though they drew him away from his aspirations as a Philophilos gazing upon God. Or we remember Luther in a bad moment. Luther did have his bad moments. You do not have to ask Christ about your duty. Ask the imperial or the territorial law. It's even possible for us to conceive ourselves as not agents at all, but simply as centers of feeling to whom things somehow happen. More adult, mature people think of themselves like that than dares to be spoken, I think. And there's a multitude of other misconceptions too. None of them are prima facie stupid, and all can claim respectable philosophical advocates. So it is possible then for men and women to be ignorant of their own agency. Perhaps very common. And therefore incompetent in its exercise, in sore need of a disclosure that will correct their understandings and so rescue them from their incompetence. All this without their having ceased at any point to be human agents, for no practical reason engaging with self-will and time is their essential mode of existing. Of what kind will such a redemptive disclosure be? The contention of monotheism, which is decisive, I think, for any ethic, is that to understand ourselves as agents, we have to understand ourselves as existing before God rather than in the midst of the gods. That said, it does not follow, not at once, that we have to understand ourselves as existing before the Trinitarian God of Christian belief. The time-structured conception of moral thought that we find in John 14 is clearly anticipated, at least, among believers in the covenant of Adonai with Israel. Adonai is the God who presents us behind and before. To take just one example, which I always find very revealing and return to whenever I can, the Long Psalm. The Long Psalm is devoted to a patient exploration of a whole range of different foci of moral experience. As elsewhere in other psalms, it makes a difference between the backward-looking and the forward-looking response to God's direction. Statutes founded forever, on the one hand, which become the topic of reflection. Paths that stretch out ahead into unknown futures, on the other hand, which one runs. Also, the transcendent presence of God in which his expressed will stands guard over the poet in the face of immediate hostility. Essential to this perception is the experience of covenant, with its historical reference back and its prophetic promise forward. And to understand how the doctrine of the Trinity can shape moral life, we have to see that it does so precisely as a fulfillment of the covenant with Israel, adumbrating the presence in time of the self-covenanting God. The correspondence between Trinity and human action that emerges from the discourse of St. John is wholly focused on the presence of the Godhead to the believing community. Which leads us to our third point. The theological tradition does not permit us to say that God present in covenant is the only reality of God that is. Neither does it permit us to say that God acting as Trinity in history is the only Trinitarian reality there is. In each case, it acknowledges a gratuity about the divine presence in history. And that presupposes God acting from behind his presence to us, as it were, not wholly accounted for by his presence to us, a God who is always greater. The covenant is an act of grace that was not in itself required by any covenant. Our talk of God cannot make itself independent of the covenant, but neither can it forget that everything we say about the acts of God in covenant is governed by that always greater. What we learn from life in covenant, then, is by no means everything there is to be known about God, nor indeed about God as Trinity. Questions such as increasingly absorb John Webster about the aseity of God are not to be answered from a mirroring of the divine in human moral experience. Nor could human moral experience say anything about divine decisions before the foundation of the world, or divine omnipotence and counterfactual worlds, such as Lombard taught the scholastics to think so much about. Those considerations, then, should ensure that our claims for an analogy of moral reason with the divine Trinity remain modest. Yet, within the scope of modesty, there are some real claims to be made. If we're not entitled to think ourselves in possession of an imago Dei through the structure of our moral reasoning, we may, nevertheless, find at least the promise of a similitude of Dei within them, an invitation to live out a conformity between God's gracious presence to us and our responsive action. It is the glory of human action, we are told, to follow in the pattern of the divine action. Because the acting God has in three persons entered covenant with us, we may claim our freedom to act more fully and more comprehendingly. We may know our own freedom, not as an empty idea to be asserted by self-positing bluster, but as a way to live in community with God in Trinity, who meets us in our active relations to self, world, and time. A clear grasp of the form of our own action then serves to confirm the decisive self-presencing of God to us. It is a kind of sign following. With which, let me return to where I began, which is the mutual service of dogmatics and ethics in theology. In the order of knowledge, John Webster asserted, we may speak sometimes of a priority of ethics and sometimes of a priority of dogmatics. We should not think of them as having different material bases. Each listens to the word of Scripture interpreted through the Spirit within the Church, and its validity is dependent on the faithfulness of its hearing. In my view, going a step further, I think, than John was ready to allow, we may suppose different modes of reasoning. For moral reasoning, as I understand it, is fundamentally inductive reasoning, while dogmatic reasoning is fundamentally analytic. Yet there can be no challenging John's judgment that in the material order, as opposed to the order of knowledge, there is a disequilibrium between dogmatics and ethics that simply has to be respected. Dogmatics is responsible for accounting theologically for the actual. The Word of God, as it has been and is. The historical, the unchanging, the created, the miraculous, the fact of witness, and the fact of given promise. And ethics has then to follow a train of reasoning from the actual to the possible, concluding in the purposing of a human action, yet to be performed, a human life yet to be lived, and therefore not yet actual. But since possibility depends on what is actual, ethics must accept the position of following dogmatics, of seeking life on the basis of what it has learned of God's deeds and promises. If it tries to break free, it will become merely aspirational, an ethics of the abstract ideal, an ethics of the world that would be nice but doesn't exist. And so it would become a salt that has lost its practical savour. Jesus spoke of two men going up to the temple to pray, one who gave thanks for the life he lived, the other who prayed for mercy. And the second, as we know, left the temple with God's approval, and the first was rejected. It can be all too tempting to the ethicist, among whom I include not only the professional practitioners of ethics, philosophical and theological, but that vast number who suppose themselves to be guided primarily by ethical considerations. It can be tempting to see the Pharisee and the publican as dogmatician and ethicist, respectively. The one content to describe the way being is, the other aspiring to set wrong, to set right all that is wrong. Augustine liked to say of the Pharisee that he went up to pray, but did not ask for anything. He was not, that is, a practical reasoner. While the publican, for his part, both reasoned and asked, cogitabat et petebat. Does that critical comment invalidate the attitude of praise and thanksgiving, which, after all, the Pharisee shares with the dogmatician? Of course it doesn't. The wise dogmatician, and I speak, of course, of John Webster, knows what the Pharisee did not know. That although praise and thanksgiving are the ultimate mode of reflecting upon God's works, they cannot, before the end of all things, become self-reflections. Our praise on earth is about thou, not about I. The wise dogmatician also knows that knowledge is inseparable from holiness, and holiness inseparable from knowledge, but that unity of knowledge and holiness must take form before an eschatological horizon. Understanding the future as promise, he understands the renewed self as promised. A challenge, an offer to reach out to from praise in practical trust. He understands that cognitive conditions of theology of pilgrimage, that is, reining in the ambition for comprehensive doctrines that can wrap ourselves and our actions wholly into the creative order without remainder, and pretend to find ourselves as finished and entire as God found his works to be on the seventh day of creation. That position is open to the wise dogmatician. Can the ethicist be as wise as that? It may be all too easy, as Basil Mitchell remarked 50 years ago, delightfully, for the energetic moralist to imagine himself in the role of the publican, entitled to thank God that I am not of this Pharisee. We are familiar enough with the temptation to assert peremptory moral conditions for believing in God. I could never worship a God who would do this or that or whatever it is. But the wise and self-knowing ethicist will understand that no one is ever in a position to dictate moral terms to reality. And so pretend to take over the descriptive function that is in fact not the ethicist's prerogative. Such an ethics would be worse than a salt that had lost its practical savour. It would be a pseudoscience or a theosophy of some kind. It is what John Webster had in mind when he dismissed the idea of ethics as a first theology. In sacrificing practicality in order to embark on world description, it would simply end up as an ideology dictating to experience when it ought to follow experience, pretending to tell the truth about the universe on the basis of projection of its agency and wishful thinking. Rather reminiscent of certain referendum campaigns. Balthazar once described such syntheses of ethics and dogmatics as a gnosis that claims to be as coextensive as the agony that works God's will. If, on the other hand, we avoid that peril and find in theological ethics a more complete fruition of the gift of moral reasoning that is given in common to all Adam's children, that can only be because ethics has first been privileged to listen. To listen, among other things, to dogmatic representations of an actual God. A God who has beset us behind, and not only before. Thank you very much.